NBC News has learned that Trump attorney Michael Cohen is trying to silence adult film star Stormy Daniels from speaking out about her, quote, intimate relationship with Donald Trump. According to documents obtained by NBC, Cohen got a secret temporary restraining order against Daniels just over a week ago from a private arbitrator. The order barred her from disclosing confidential information related to a non-disclosure agreement that was signed in October 2016. Daniels, whose real name is Stephanie Clifford, filed a lawsuit against the president Tuesday, alleging that a non-disclosure agreement she previously signed is invalid because Mr. Trump never signed it. According to the suit, Cohen attempted to intimidate Daniels and, quote, shut her up by initiating what the lawsuit calls a bogus arbitration hearing against her. White House Press Secretary Sarah Huckabee Sanders said yesterday an arbitration case against Daniels had been won, but did not offer details. She also said, as far as she's aware, President Trump did not know his lawyer had paid Daniels $130,000 to ensure her silence.
Did the president approve of the payment that was made in October of 2016 by his longtime lawyer and advisor, Michael Cohen?
Look, the president has addressed these directly and made very well clear that none of these allegations are true. This case has already been won in arbitration, and anything beyond that, I would refer you to the president's outside counsel.
And did he know about the payment at the time?
Not that I'm aware of.
You said that there's arbitration that's already been won? By whom and when?
By the president's personal attorneys, and for details on that, I would refer you to them.
A lawyer for Stormy Daniels responded to Sanders' comments last night on MSNBC.
It's absolutely bogus. It's nonsense. Any claim by the administration that Donald Trump won in arbitration is no different than me claiming that I won the Super Bowl a few weeks ago.
President Trump's attorney, Michael Cohen, previously has said rumors of a sexual encounter have been vehemently denied by President Trump and by Ms. Clifford, who's also known as Stormy Daniels. So, Joe, that same attorney for Stormy Daniels said yesterday on a different show, implying that he didn't want to say yet, but that he may have information that could show President Trump directed Mr. Cohen to make this payment.
Jonathan, a lot of people have looked at what Michael Cohen have done, especially attorneys that I know, just scratched their head, looked at the sloppiness of setting up a corporation that could be traced back to their client, this agreement that he drafted. What's your takeaway? What red flags are raised?
It's really otherworldly. I've never seen anything like this. It sort of falls in that category of, you know, if we keep our eyes closed, no one can see us. I mean, it just doesn't make any sense at all legally.
Wait, people can see you if you close your eyes? Oh, my God.
But it's such a departure, not just from ordinary practice, but from logic. I mean, using all these fake names, which by the way, you then put in parens, AKA, with a line for the real name. And it's sort of like, why are you going through this exercise? Cohen could not have made the situation worse for his client or for himself. Ultimately, none of this is following a trajectory we've seen before. Even the use of an arbitrator to issue this type of prior restraint doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make any sense to say that he won an arbitration that the other party has never been a party to.
Right.
So we're in a strange area now, and this is not going to turn out well for any of the parties. In terms of Stormy Daniels, she took $130,000 to stay quiet. And so in terms of Trump not signing it, there is still a plausible argument that she has a contract here that has to be fulfilled. On the other hand, the contract itself is just riddled with problems. And so her lawyer has some very good arguments to make, in my view, that this is not binding, including the argument that Cohen himself nullified the agreement.
I can't imagine, also on another side of it, federal elections laws. I can't imagine a congressman or a senator having a personal lawyer pay somebody off $130,000 out of their own pocket before a couple of weeks before their election came about, and then I guess Trump still the candidate still hasn't paid back the attorney. And I mean, speaking of barbecue, if somebody gave me a barbecue dinner at a fundraiser, we meticulously figured out how much that barbecue was worth, and we had to immediately report it to the FEC as an in-kind contribution. If you're talking about $130,000 in hush money, this does remind me of John Edwards. There are real federal laws here that are at issue.
Look, this I've said for weeks now that the Stormy Daniels issue represents a serious threat. If Mueller actually can pursue this issue within his mandate, and he can ask the president, if he sits down with them, about the details of that affair. And that is a road that we've seen other politicians go down. It has not come out well. So the question I have also is the ethical one. I tell my students all the time when we go through hypotheticals, mm-hmm. who are you at this point? You know, I don't know who Cohen was when he was signing that document. Was he a friend of the president? Was he a fixer? It didn't seem like he was a lawyer. Lawyers don't pay settlements or pay money like this on behalf of clients.
So who does this?
Oh, no one I know of. I mean, this is like taking yourself hostage.
Okay.
you just sort of watch it and go, wow.
And what are examples of people hostage. Doing this for someone? What are they, friends? Or?
Well, that's the odd thing here is that the situation is even worse because of the report that Cohen said later that he was delayed in paying the money because he couldn't reach the president. And then there was this suggestion that he might have complained to others that Trump hadn't actually ponied up the money.
Oh, my God.
So all of that creates a rather target-rich environment for a prosecutor. This is, it's not a stretch to say that this can be a campaign finance violation. Doesn't mean it is, but as you've already noted, someone got indicted for something like this, John Edwards. Right. Mueller would not be moving too far off his mandate to ask about it.
And so Jeremy, you say we know that Mueller is gone there.
We know that Mueller is asking questions about Michael Cohen. This kind of gets overlooked in the other pursuits of Mueller's. Manafort, Gates, mm-hmm. Flynn, but Cohen has. There's a lot out there, right? And so, but it does get lost that people who have spoken with Mueller's team have said recently that Cohen appears to be focused. Now, we don't know whether or not he was asking about Stormy Daniels, but I think after the developments of the last few days, it's safe to assume that he certainly will now.
Will he?
You know, Casey, Bob Mueller is already looking at Michael Cohen. We should remind people as part of the Russia investigation, deals that may or may not have been made at Trump Tower. So his eyes are already on Michael Cohen. His eyes may already be on emails of Michael Cohen. So this could sort of metastasize into something else if you lay in the Stormy Daniels layer on top of it.
Very easily. And I mean, the thing about, we were just talking here about what kind of role did Michael Cohen actually play? I mean, you can't have a conversation about nearly anything to do with President Trump without talking about Michael Cohen. I mean, this is somebody who was by his side day in, day out. If you wandered into Trump Tower anytime, if you were covering the campaign, I mean, I was there for the announcement, I would cover Trump on the road. He was there.
Yeah.
He knows everything. He is all of the things, Jonathan Turley, that you were saying. Fixer, friend, you know, behind the scenes, cleanup. There's no way that all of his activities are not, you know, central to all of this. And, you know, I just keep going back to this. How is it that we're talking about this? It's just the president of the United States. And I mean, legal questions aside, I mean, the man has an affair with a porn star and pays her off, and this is
not okay. Like, forget make America great again. We're going to need to make America good again, because this does not sound like a very good man at all leading the country.
Joe, Mikael, I'll just say two things about Michael Cohen, someone who I have had interactions with over the course of the last decade or so. There are two things. One, he is the ultimate Trump loyalist. We know there are lots of loyalists around Donald Trump. This is a person who has freely said to journalists and others that he would happily take a bullet for Donald Trump. It may be that he is actually about to take a bullet for Donald Trump. And the second thing is that the notion that Michael Cohen, I mean, the notion that any lawyer, as Jonathan Turley just said, would go out and write a check on behalf of a client, anybody who's had any dealings with lawyers knows how implausible that is, let alone a $130,000 check without having discussed it first with his client. I mean, in this case, given Donald Trump's cheapness, let's put it that way, there's no way that Michael Cohen went out and wrote a $130,000 check on behalf of Donald Trump without having consulted Donald Trump before doing so. So those are I think you're right, Joe. I think, you know, the John Edwards case, another case I'm very familiar with, they did not have the facts in the end to get a conviction there. But this is dangerous territory because it does wrap up, first of all, a scandal that could bring into the public view. If there are photographs that are compromising, if those photographs exist, they will come out. And so there's that element of that tied into the facts that touch on federal election law and then tied into Michael Cohen, who not just on this case, but on a variety of other levels related to business dealings of Donald Trump's overseas, yeah. is also himself a target-rich environment.
So can you explain, John Hallman, not that I really want to hear this, but what is the potential that there might be photographs? How did that come into this conversation?
Well, there's a legal document in one of the exchanges in these legal documents. The Daniels team says that part of this confidentiality agreement that was struck back in 2016 and part of the ongoing confidentiality agreement relates to communications between Stormy Daniels and Donald Trump under their aliases. And one of the things that's pointed to in a very suggestive way is the notion that there are potentially compromising photographs that she might have in her possession. Again, no one knows whether they actually exist, and although they are pointed to, I believe, more than once in the document, and no one knows what those might be, although, again, having some if you think about the past of the kind of scandals of this nature, a photograph of Donald Trump and Stormy Daniels at Mar-a-Lago would not really fall in the category potentially compromising. So it has raised among many people the speculation that those photographs might be intimate photographs of the President of the United States. And Mika, I'll hope as you conjure an image of that, I'll try to just urge you not to throw up in your mouth.
So Willie, you have to look at the personal side of this, the personal dimension of this. People who are president of the United States and their family members have to deal with so much, even under normal circumstances. And you look at this, and certainly the chaos that this obviously will bring to anyone's personal life. And it's hard not to ask whether this is in part part of the drama and part of the chaos that has caused the President of the United States to be churning the way he has over the past week.
Well, any right-thinking human being would be concerned if there were something like what John's describing possibly going to be thrown out into the public view. Lay on top of that, to the President of the United States, then yeah, I think that would concern you. I agree. I think, you know, conservative and Republican support for this president remains incredibly high, although his new numbers we'll talk about overall are high 30s. You have to look at this. At some point, the evidence becomes undeniable that there was an alleged affair, that there was an alleged payment, that he hasn't allegedly paid back the person who made the payment on his behalf, that it allegedly all took place a week or two before the election. How can you say, when you look at all these pieces, this is fake news, this is made up, the media is out to get my president of the United States? If you are one of the evangelicals you're talking about, how can you stand by and watch this and support the man? If you actually look at all the reporting and you look at all the evidence that's in front of us and you don't believe it, boy, I think you're living in some other fantasy world.
Well, it was that the question that Willie just asked is the same question that every evangelical that I knew. And I knew a lot because Southern Baptist my whole life. It's the same question they were asking of Democrats in the 1990s.
Oh,
how
sure.
could
right.
they support Bill Clinton? I heard it time and time again. This proves that the Democratic Party and Democrats are immoral. They don't care about anything but power. It's what I heard every Sunday and every Wednesday night. As Democrats blindly stood by Bill Clinton, that's now a question, of course, that Democrats are asking of evangelicals.
Well, they're being asked a lot of them at this point because they've really stretched to get to this point.